make my wife so jealous.
And y'all have more than onions.
This is Ham Radio Now at the North Carolina Mountain State Fair. What are we doing at a fair? Well, you know, fairs, state fairs, county fairs have a lot of hobbies and crafts. That's, you know, what they're pretty much famous for. But how often do you see a ham radio exhibit at one? I'm guessing not very often. There probably are some, but not a whole lot. So there's one here, and I found out about it. In fact, I was invited. I was strongly encouraged to come out and check it out, and so I did. And we will see what it takes to put on a major exhibit at a large fair operation. So that is what Ham Radio Now is doing at a fair. That and eating funnel cake. Red velvet funnel cake. Get your heart out, Cindy. I think we're both here and might even be able to hear each other.
Oh, good.
So who am I talking to?
I'm Bill Van Nuys, N4OOC, president of the Roadshow Amateur Radio Club in Western North Carolina.
And explain to me a little bit about what it is I am standing in front of.
You're standing in front of the demonstration tent of amateur radio that has been assembled by the cooperating clubs of Western North Carolina. We have five amateur radio clubs participating here: the Roadshow Amateur Radio Club, the Haywood County Amateur Radio Club, the Blue Ridge Amateur Radio Club, and the Cleveland County Amateur Radio Society.
And where are we?
We're at the North Carolina Mountain State Fair near the Asheville Airport, and we're demonstrating amateur radio to the world.
Okay, so you've got pretty serious operation set up here, it would appear.
Yes, we have three HF stations going, running a special event station, N4F. We are have a GOTA station on 2 meters. We have a D-Star station up and running. We have an APRS demonstration. We also have demonstrations of some of the several balloon launches we have done in cooperation with Western Carolina University Physics Department, and where we've provided communications and tracking of weather balloons, and we had the video from several of those launches, all to show the public what amateur radio is about. We're out here trying to recruit 50 new ham operators.
50, count them, 50.
Count them, 50. Our goal last year, this is the second year we've done this, we tried to get 50 last year. We fell short. We only got 25. But that's 25 more than we had.
Let's talk about that in a minute. You've also got a pretty huge antenna farm going here.
Oh, yes. Well, we've got a 10, 15, and 20-meter beam. We've got a 20-meter delta loop with adjustable feed, so we can operate at vertical or horizontal polarization. We have a BMW 80 through 10 terminator or folded dipole. We've got several VHF antennas. We've got a vertical mounted on the roof of the operations trailer over there. And we have mesh dish up, running ham mesh. And I want to point out that everything you see here, with two exceptions, the tent was rented from a commercial company, and the North Carolina Mountain State Fair provided us with the space. Everything else has been provided by amateur radio operators, including the wireless internet. We're all hams, we're all cooperating together and putting on this event.
Now, the Mountain State Fair is not the official North Carolina State Fair, because we're a long way from where that fair is in Raleigh. We're like 5-6 hours away, right?
Well, this is the official North Carolina Mountain State Fair.
Because we're in the mountains, and
that's
it's much
right.
prettier
this
up here.
This is an official state fair. It's just in the western end.
Technically, it's cooler, but it's still hot and humid.
Well, now, it was 66 this morning.
Okay, it's not 66 now.
Not
actually,
60.
It's comfortable now as the
clouds are moving in. In fact, we're going to try to beat a storm front to finish off here this outdoor interview.
It never rains at the fair.
This is the second year that you've done this.
Yes.
This was your idea?
This has been attempted over the years, many years, and it's usually wound up to be a couple of good old boys in the back corner somewhere.
So they actually got out here and set up a station.
They got out here, but it was never easy to find or never up front. I thought that we
and
should...
And that bothered you?
It bothered me. We're trying to avoid the typical concept of the amateur radio guy as the radio's hanging all over him and his sloppy hat and so forth and so on. And
I'm going to look at your guys very carefully now.
Yes. But amateur radio is a lot more than the guy walking around with a walkie-talkie and the antenna mounted on his hat. We do emergency communications. We do...
Now, you realize you're talking to an audience of hams.
I am?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
This is Ham Radio Now. You don't have to explain what Ham Radio is to them. And you're in that mode, though. You've been explaining what Ham Radio is now for how many days?
We started a week ago Friday. The fair goes for 10 days. And we've been, we'll wind up this Friday or this Sunday. We're trying to bring all these concepts to the public. And a week from tonight, we will start the first technician class of the fall. We already have 10 people signed up with the roadshow. And the following week, the Blue Ridge Club in Hendersonville has another class starting. So
I can see this is going to be a typical Ham Radio Now scattershot interview, but you just brought up something very interesting. You are not giving people a glimpse of ham radio and then cast them off. You've got an instant follow-up.
That's exactly right. That's what we're trying. That's why we have them scheduled, the classes to start the following week. And the technician class will end in October, and the first week of November, we are going to be offering a general class.
What kind of attendance does this fair see daily and maybe throughout the course of the 10 days?
Throughout the course of the 10 days, we will see approximately between 190 to 200,000 people.
Okay, for the whole fair?
For the whole fair.
Yeah, so the state fair in Raleigh sees that every day.
But yes.
So this is about 10% of that big fair, but I would hasten to point out, which is my hometown, we have never done a ham radio exhibit at that state fair. So,
by the way,
you're way ahead of us.
I was approached by a member of the Raleigh Radio Club and said, "That's a good idea. We should do that at the fair."
We should.
That was at Shelby last week.
Really? Yeah. It is. And I got a feeling that this show is going to trigger a lot of people all over the place to say that's a good idea. We should do something like that. So. We should tell them that this is not easy.
This is not easy. And it's not cheap either.
All right. Tell me about it.
We initially undertook, number one, the Roadshow Club is a very young club. We're only 4 years old.
So you're not smart enough to know you can't do this?
We're not smart enough to know we can't do this. We started the first event last year. We decided to do it. We had approximately $150 in the treasury. Well,
you don't
it
anymore.
Cost about $2,500 to put this event on, even though the fairgrounds gives you the land, but you still have expenses. You have tents to rent. You have posters to put up, and so forth and so on. So we went drastically in the hole last year. We've been doing fundraising since March. This year.
How'd you go about doing that?
Well, Elecraft made us such a deal on a K3 100 factory built radio, and we have been raffling it off. We have not raffled it off yet. We started with 600 tickets, and when we sell ticket number one, we will give it to the lucky ham that has won it. Meanwhile, they've also, all these donations have gone towards supporting amateur radio, public relations amateur radio.
All right. So what's your total budget for this year?
About $2,000.
All right. And what about people? this is not a one-man operation. I can already see that you got a half a dozen people out here right now. Of course, you brought them all out because you knew you were going to be on Ham Radio Now.
I knew Ham Radio Now. I put the word out that Ham Radio Now is going to be here, and they all showed up.
But this is 10 days worth of staffing. At what hours do you keep?
Well, we have 196 hours of operations. Now, remember, we're running two HF stations. They have to be manned. We're running at least two people in the tent to interface with the public.
Okay, let me stop you right there. You got somebody on the air.
Yes.
You got somebody else to talk to the people who are coming by to watch.
Yes.
The guy on the air is not trying to do the not trying to talk to the public.
No, he's not.
Okay. Pay attention. There's going to be a quiz. All right, move on.
The fair runs during the weekends from 9 a.m. to 10 p.m. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. During the week, it runs from 3 to 10 p.m. On Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Then, again, on the following Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, it runs 10 to 10.
Now, are you open here whenever the fair is open?
Whenever the fair is open, we are open. That is our contract with the fair folk, and we have to live up to that.
And how do you get that staffing? You're going to give another Elecraft to somebody who's working, right?
Well, we wish. We wish we could. By the way, I don't want to short ICOM. Last year, ICOM provided us with two HF radios, actually two HF radios and a D-Star radio for demonstration purposes for the HF station and the D-Star station here in the tent. This year, ICOM is supplying us with two HF radios, a 7600 and a 7100. And Elecraft is supplying us with one of those K3-100s. So we're showing people what modern amateur radio equipment it is. Tentec provided us with some kits. We have a working workbench, which is one of the new things we added this year, to show that we actually build things and repair things. We've brought several people who come in and say, I have my license. I haven't been on the air in 10 years. Well, why not?
Let me go back first. Let me go back to your staffing. How do you recruit people?
Well, we recruit people by, number one, inviting each and every amateur radio club in Western North Carolina. Everybody from I-77 West.
So it's a cooperative effort among a bunch of clubs.
They have all been ordered or invited.
Have they all responded?
No. Some failed to even acknowledge the communication that they received it.
So typical.
It's typical.
But you got response from some.
Got response from some.
Kicking and screaming or enthusiasm or some of both?
Some of both. It's sort of like organizing a herd of cats.
Yeah.
Yes. But the Friday, Saturday, and Sunday is manned by everybody of the five clubs. We have volunteers from each one. The Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the individual clubs take one day and run the 3 to 10 shift and give everybody else a rest. Monday was the Cleveland County Amateur Radio Society. Tuesday was the Blue Ridge Amateur Radio Club.
So they get responsible for filling their specific slot of time. It's on them.
Yes, it's on them. Now, tomorrow we will open at 9 a.m.
You did say we're right by the airport, didn't you?
Yes, we are right across from the airport, folks. We're interrupted every once in a while by one of those little
jumbo
jets.
We're talking close enough to,
yes,
for people to hear us. Okay, so the clubs fill their slots.
Yeah, when we go, we're not choosy about who operates. As long as they're licensed.
You kind of can't be, or you'd never get enough people, right?
There's a little group down in that little town. What is it, in Georgia? Atlanta? Oh, yes. The president of the Atlanta Radio Club, Amateur Radio Club, will be here tomorrow night and Saturday. He's going to come up and operate. He just wanted to.
Next year, this is going to be, because of the show, this is going to be a super prestige event. You'll
be
beating them off with sticks.
Yes, yes.
Are there some times when it's too thin or when you just wish you had more people? You're open all the time.
We're open all the time.
And you come in if no one else will?
It seems to me I've been here every day. According to my wife, I've been here all week.
Yeah,
yes, it does get a little challenging, but
this is your show ultimately, right?
No, it is not my show.
Well, you're the coordinator.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
It's everybody's all the ham show.
Yes.
We'll give them credit for that.
Yes.
But somebody's got to herd those cats.
That's right. And since we own three cats of our own, we're accustomed to herding cats. So
you just won my wife over.
Yes.
And me. We're cat people.
Yes. I've noticed that, and you have help in some of your productions.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep. All right, so volunteer staffing, and some people just absolutely want to be here, and some people, I guess I'd better.
And some of them get, tongue-tied when they're talking to folks. But then again,
segue to the next thing I wanted to ask about.
That's right.
How do you teach people, or do you, how to talk to the public? Because, ham radio is, we think we know it until we try to explain it to somebody. And we get tongue-tied. We turn the fire hose on them. Well, there's HF, there's sideband, there's CW, there's ATV, there's satellites, there's astronauts. And that doesn't do you any good.
Well, 30 years of being an amateur radio hamfest dealer, you get a little practice talking to the public.
Okay, so yes. You know how to slow down and
yes.
Take it one piece at a time. But how do you teach everybody else to do that?
Well, we have professional salesmen who are hams. They instruct the
How much
PR
would you pay
people?
For this ham radio?
Yes.
But wait, there's more.
Right. Only shipping and handling. But, this club, the membership spans a very large...
a wide range of people.
Wide range of people.
A lot of experience,
wide range
of diversity.
Diversity and all kinds of skills. We have generator repairmen. We have nuclear engineers. We have NASA scientists.
You got rocket scientists.
No, actually have a... Don't tell anybody. He's a professor from Texas A&M.
Okay, any brain surgeons?
Yes, we do have a surgeon.
Okay, got rocket scientists, got brain surgeons.
Yes.
We're all set. We're covered.
The point is, the club has a broad spectrum. We even have a judge. We're not going to... And we also have youngest ham. Well, I won't brag too much.
Ethan, you're talking about Ethan. He's been on ham radio
yes,
now.
Yes, Ethan. He's He was my first...
Say hi to Ethan. He's probably watching here.
Yeah.
Hey, Ethan, how you doing?
Ethan will probably watch this, I'm sure. But we have a broad spectrum to pull from in the club and the other clubs likewise, and we pull on those talents. And we train people to talk.
Do you think you do a really good job? I personally have a thing about people trying to talk about ham radio to the public, and I don't think it's done very well. You happy with what you're getting?
No.
Okay, so it could
but
be better.
Practice, practice, practice. That's how we learn.
Yep, another couple of years.
Yes.
What kind of public do you get? What kind of response? I mean, we're not on the midway here. We're not at the absolute epicenter of the fair.
Do you
you're
between the chainsaw carver and...
And the Pigway Speedway.
And the pig races?
Yeah.
We're on Piglet Way.
Well, being next to the Pigway is, you could do
yes,
worse than
yes,
that.
Yes, we could.
Especially because it's, like the racing hams.
That's the racing hams, right. But, I lost my train.
That's okay. In these interviews, there is no train of thought.
It's a stream of
unconsciousness.
Yes. But
So we're talking about how... how good a job you think you've
yes.
explained things to the public, and what I remember where we were. What kind of public do you get? We're not overloaded here, but do you sometimes get a pretty good crowd?
Oh, we always get a steady crowd. Now we're on a Thursday night. It's stormy. The fair
I'm
opened
about
at 3
that.
O'clock.
Look at that front coming.
It never rains at the fair.
Yeah,
remember that. We get all kinds of people, but surprisingly we get few people from Buncombe County.
That's the county we're in,
that's
or the next
county,
county north?
Well, the city of Asheville and Buncombe County, we get very few people. We get a lot of people from Murphy, Georgia.
Okay, let's say hello to the folks in California right now, because folks in England, because we're worldwide.
We've had some of those folks too come to the fair.
When Gastonia? The public comes to look at this stuff, you said you get some folks that everybody who does a public ham radio demonstration ends up with one thing. I was a ham years ago and I let my license lapse. I didn't even know you were still around.
We've had lots of those. That's another thing that we're out here to do I had a young lady come in last night, and she says, my daddy was on the front of that magazine before I was born.
QST?
QST. She was pointing it. Oh, by the way, folks, you know all those QSTs you have piled up? Here is a way to get rid of them. Put one in the hand of everybody that walks into your tent. So go do a public demonstration and get rid of your QSTs.
He's getting the hang of this now, addressing the camera. All right.
Like I say, he was one of the first hams to do Earth, Moon, Earth.
Wow.
And his picture was on the face of QST. She didn't know when it was, because it was before she was born, and they have since passed. Oh, I said, well, okay, here's a copy of QST. You know it's available in digital form now. And her face lit up, and she signed up for class. So yay. What can I say?
So you get a lot of people that don't know anything about ham radio.
Yes.
You see, what attracts them, the antennas?
I think this little antenna farm we have here draws a lot of attention. We even have public service people come by and say, well, how come we can't do that?
Well, you don't have a barker out here, though, like the weight loss or the guess your weight and knock down the bowling pins. And
Alvin hasn't been here yet. He's so scheduled here Saturday.
They have a barker.
We have a barker. Remember, folks, amateur radio is a broad spectrum of folk. We have an actual barker.
All right. So when people come in with no clue, what do you – give me a pitch.
Hello, sir. How are you? Are you familiar with amateur radio?
No. It looks interesting, though. Tell me about it.
Well, here. Look here. Here's some of the things we do with emergency communications. And do you know how we found out what happened to the Titanic? No? Well, it was a CW operator that actually copied the distress signal from the Titanic.
Okay, I caught you with a pro word, CW. They're not going to understand that.
Well, that's
is a problem, right?
That's a problem, but you know what? That's the reason we have it running in the tent. We have CW operators sitting back there running it. And having a CW signal coming out of the tent seems to draw a lot of folk. What's that? Original form of digital communications. What can I say?
People say that Morse code is really attractive to kids.
Yes.
Catches their attention in particular. They want to learn it a little bit, you know, a little rudimentary, one or two letters. Adults, too?
Yes. You have to remember, Asheville still holds the world record for CW. Plain copy.
I didn't know that. What's the record?
The record was set here at the Asheville Ham Fest, and I believe it was 1938 by Mr. McElroy.
Okay, so you were definitely not the first station at the the Asheville Ham Fest,
Asheville Ham Fest.
Okay.
Yes, it was 1938, and that was 70 some words a minute.
McElroy, the guy with the bugs.
Yeah, the McElroy with the bugs. Something about when the tape ran out, he typed on the typewriter for another 2 minutes. And that was from the Boston Globe, I believe it was.
All right. So you guys have some history here.
Yes. Some history here in the mountains.
Let me back you up here.
We're
getting out of frame. So it's popular. You're not overloaded, though. I mean, you don't ever have a line of people waiting to get in.
No, we never have a line of people, but we have a steady flow, and that's what we're after. That gives us time to talk to each and every individual.
You said your goal is 50 hams out of probably several thousand people that come by during the course
of
things.
Figure that
that's modest.
If you have 200,000 people come to the fair and you have half of those walk by you and half of those that stop in and half of those that stop in show some interest and half of those that show some interest actually do something, how else can you come up with 50 hams?
Well, what I'm getting at is that your goal is reasonable.
Yes.
And you don't have that goal of making everybody that you encounter try to become a ham. That's not reasonable.
One of the things that I see wrong with amateur radio is all the hams are trying to look like me. They're all trying to get white hair.
Yeah.
Well, I want to see more hams that don't have white hair. And don't go out and buy hair dye. We need to start young folks.
Let's talk about getting the young hams in a minute, if I remember. But I wanted to tag on to this public thing. If you're not trying to get everybody to become a ham,
no.
Then what's your goal?
Let them know what we do.
And why? Why is that important?
Well, we get a lot of criticism. One of the criticisms we experienced here earlier this week, the fire department and the security people are having communications problems with their own communications. And, oh, it's those hams over there doing all that noise.
Oh, no.
And I said, well, what's the matter, gentlemen? Well, in the afternoon, all that noise, we can't communicate.
They're talking about here at the fair?
Here
at the fair.
Well, I said, can I look at your communication center? Well, okay. Well, they have some bag mounts stuck up to the steel structure under the steel roof on one of the steel buildings, and gee, I wonder why they don't get out.
Okay, so they don't have a radio engineer setting their stuff up.
No.
I mean, they've got radio engineers, but for some reason they didn't bring one out here.
But as soon as they have problems, it's always hams. And any of you ham radio operators out there know all too well that if you put an antenna up in the neighborhood, you've wiped out all the communications in the four-county area.
Not to mention an eyesore, and there go the property values.
Oh, yes.
So you're working on that angle some.
Yes.
Do you get any legislators, any city council, any officials that come by and look at things that you know of?
None that have identified any, but maybe some of them will be someday. You never can tell.
But you're giving your neighbors a little bit of ham radio exposure,
yes,
in a positive manner, and they get to ask questions.
They know we're weird, but we show them why we're weird.
Yep.
And why we sit there and talk on the radio hours and hours, or type on, you know, send the did-das, or look at the little squiggly line on that PSK signal and say, oh, I talked to him.
I think the rain is about...
Oh, did you think it's going to rain?
I think it's going to. Well, we'll go as long as we can.
The raindrops are starting to fall.
Maybe we'll go inside if we have to finish up. Because yes. I don't think I'm anywhere near done asking questions. Okay, so the young people. You get young people coming to look?
Yes.
What do they seem interested in besides tapping on the Morse code?
We have a lot. We have digital going here. We have various digital demonstrations. Anything digital they seem to be very interested in. Here in the mountains, there are a lot of people that hike and camp. We're pointing out the advantages of APRS, because folks, we all know that cell phones don't work everywhere. Well, we have an APRS network here in the mountains that we've found many, many hikers and campers that have gotten distress. Folks, you can take a small handheld with you out into the woods, and if you get in trouble, we know where to look for you.
He says woods. He means deep forest. I mean, national forests all over the place here.
Yes.
And you can get a long way from civilization.
Very quickly, very easily.
So I decided not to bring the fuzz balls on the microphones because it wasn't windy, and now it's windy.
Just remember, it doesn't rain at the fair either.
I'm just worried that we're getting a lot of blow on the mics here. Let's go inside the tent and finish up. We'll be right back for part two. Okay, so you guys have to share that microphone.
Oh, here. Talk with a professional salesperson.
We have come indoors, and that's the Elecraft. Bill, if you'll step aside there, you're covering up the Elecraft station. There you go. There's our HF station. I'm told you're the professional salesperson.
Well, I...
Hold that microphone good and close.
I've worked in the field for a number of years.
All right. So I was talking to Bill about how you talk to the general public about ham radio without pointing the fire hose at them and just overloading them instantly. How do you do that?
Well, first of all, if there's any interest at all, and we can usually gauge that here at the fair. If they walk by, if an antenna captures their attention and they point, then there's some interest there. So we'll just say, what can you tell us about what you're seeing there? Well, they may know something about an antenna, or maybe they don't, but their curiosity is certainly raised. And so that's our opening to talk about amateur radio. And we tell them that amateur radio is about talking to people across the oceans, across the country, across the state, or across the street. And you can do all that with amateur radio.
You can do that with my cell phone.
Well, not dependably, you can't.
So far,
and mostly. But it's also part of the art and the science and the fun of having all that at your fingertips. And without having to go through a long learning curve to acquire that knowledge. And so that usually gets their interest piqued, and we tell them about licensing, how it's easier now to get an amateur radio license than it's ever been. That
keep that mic up there.
Morse code is...
You must be a CW operator. I have trouble with CW operators doing the microphone thing down to there.
You may have trouble with me then. we tell them how easy it is to get an amateur radio license, and how people of all ages can get a radio license. We've had a member who was just under 6 years old. He was 5 years old.
Yeah, that's Ethan. We all have heard about
that's Ethan.
We know about Ethan.
So we know about Ethan, and we tell them about other people who, even though they've been retired for a number of years, want to get into the hobby, and it's just as easy for them to get a license also.
So as you're getting started with somebody, what kind of cues do you pay attention to from them for how to keep proceeding with your pitch? Do you just give them a spiel no matter what they are, no matter how they seem to be reacting, or are you listening to their questions and watching their eyes glaze over?
Well, if they have questions, they're interested. And so usually that sparks a conversation.
I think we came inside just in time.
Usually that sparks a conversation about someone they knew who was a ham. Maybe there was a family member, or
everybody's
that
got
sort
a grandpa
a
who was a ham,
well,
or an uncle,
but
a weird uncle.
But most of those people have been turned off by amateur radio because they felt like there was a barrier to entry, which was Morse code or a very strong technical requirement. And so we explain how the licensing procedure is today. And how easy it is for people just with a little bit of effort to be able to obtain an amateur radio license and get on the air themselves.
So people have a general misunderstanding. They may be interested, but they think that there's no way they can get there.
That's what we find, is that there's a lot of misconceptions about amateur radio in the general public.
And so the Morse code thing surprise a lot of people that you don't need to know Morse code anymore?
That surprises them, and we explain that, you know, Morse code was the only mode of operation when amateur radio began, but now it's just one of a whole variety of modes that people have available to them. And so because of that, the Morse code is no longer a requirement for licensing. It's certainly a very valid mode that a lot of people enjoy, but there's other modes out there also that people enjoy.
So when... What's the result of talking to someone for a while?
Generally,
it's not going to be one thing, but what kind of range of interest do you end up seeing?
Well, we try and steer them to the fact that if it's that easy to get a license, the next step is to have something in place that allows them to do that. And so we always have a licensing class following our fair that's easy for people to get into that class because it allows them to have their questions answered immediately. We explain to them that they can study independently and get their license, and many people go that route. But having a licensing class allows them to come and attend and get many of their questions answered immediately that they might have through the process.
Do you have any other kind of follow-up or one-on-one to people that somebody interested can then contact and get some... Something besides going to a class?
Well, we always give them some contact information, and we follow up with them. If they're interested enough to put their name down and give us some contact information, we follow up with them with a phone call, remind them of the class, and usually there's a scheduling conflict with some people. But generally, most people that express that interest, they do follow up with a class, or they'll study independently. What we do is open that door and let them know that barrier to entry is really very low in terms of getting a license.
After people have finished with a class, this isn't part of the fair deal anymore, but just curious, after people have finished with a class, are they then cut loose on their own, or do they have some support?
They have support through whatever club that they choose to join. It may be the Roadshow Club, it may be other clubs in the area, and there's plenty of clubs for people to enjoy and plug in, and a lot of people do find their home, their niche, if you will, in the various clubs in the local area. So there is plenty of support and structure for those people going forward.
All right. So, and you invite people to club to attend club meetings,
oh, absolutely.
I suppose. You have information
absolutely.
About that.
We give them that information about our particular club or other clubs in the area for them to attend, whatever's convenient for them.
People want to get on the air? Here at the demonstration station?
Yes, we've had young children come in who are just thrilled to get on the air and talk on the radio, even if it's across the street, as we say. We usually plant someone across the street with an HT that can talk to the young people, and they're just thrilled with doing that.
Yeah, because they don't know. But you've got the HF station,
right.
Which if propagation is kind to you, then you can talk worldwide.
Right.
What kind of things do people get interested in what we're doing here is letting someone know, a ham who says, oh, I want to do this in my fair.
Mm-hmm.
The things that work and the things that don't. What works?
What works is getting people in and dispelling some of those misconceptions that they have. Believe it or not, some of those misconceptions are with existing hams. Or hams who have let their license lapse and they think that they still have to go back and reapply.
You got something
the whole
new
procedure.
For them now, right?
Well, the no-code tech licensing procedure, but if it's within a certain period of time, they could retest, or as a new ruling that's come out.
That's the new thing I'm talking about.
Right. They can reapply.
Right.
And I don't know all the mechanics of that,
yeah. Okay,
but I know that that's possible.
I can explain that if you had an extra and it's lapsed a long time ago, you can get your extra back, but you have to take the tech test.
Yes.
And pass that. So you got to demonstrate mm-hmm. some interest, but you don't have to go all the way mm-hmm. back to extra, because God knows that test is hard.
But we do have a lot of hams that come by.
I'd never be able to pass my extra again, never.
We do have hams come by who are inactive, and this sort of piques their interest because they learn all the new things that they just haven't been exposed to in a long time. And so they wind up being active again.
So for the general public, people who weren't hams, what kind of things really do you do that really catches their interest? And again, I'm not trying to suggest everybody needs to go become a ham. That's mm-hmm. not what we're trying to do. It's just to get a favorable impression. What works in doing that?
Echolink, IRLP, PSK 31.
They're never going to understand that stuff, but they can see.
But we could show them what that is and demonstrate that to them. And so once they see and hear that capability, they're impressed with that.
I was going to say they're never going to understand it. You get engineers though. You do. I mean, in the audience that comes by, you get some engineers.
Absolutely.
Who have a good technical background, mm-hmm. but they've never been a ham.
Right.
And you're saying, excuse me, why not?
That's true.
And then you tell them you don't have to learn Morse code anymore, and they go, no. And maybe that gets them.
Yeah. Well, again, that's just another one of those roadblocks that fall down and in the misconception area of amateur radio.
What have you put a lot of effort into that just fell flat, didn't work? I'm not going to do that again.
excuse me, that's hard to say. You never know what's fully successful and what's not, because you never know when someone leaves here that they really just came by and it was this interesting discussion and they didn't do anything with it. We've been surprised by people who we thought had gone by the wayside, and yet we wind up hearing them on the air a year or so later. So that's quite surprising.
That'd probably be pretty gratifying.
Yes.
Hear somebody talking on the repeater and say, yeah, I stopped by that station at the Mountain Fair mm-hmm. and got interested, and here I am.
Yes. We have people like
whoa.
That. We have people who have done that. And so that's encouraging to us. But again, you know, we're casting a broad net. We never know fully who leaves here with an impression that they're actually going to follow up on, unless they wind up in one of our classes.
Okay. So you look over here at the camera and say, there isn't anything that you would say to the people out there watching, don't do that, you're wasting your time.
Oh no, absolutely. Amateur radio, I tell people it's like the spokes on a wheel. There's something in it for everyone. There's an interest.
These are hams. The hams are watching. We don't have to sell them on ham radio. What we are teaching these people is what to do to make something like this, a demonstration operation like this, what to do. What are the one, two, maybe three things that you absolutely have to do? when you're putting this together?
Well, you have to have good teamwork among people who want to see this sort of who want to see amateur radio put in the public spotlight. And so we've got a good group of people that want to do that. That's generally people who like to operate, get on the air, and they want to show other people how easy that is.
You have to have a big antenna farm?
No, not necessarily.
But you have to have something on the air.
You have to have something, but even a simple wire antenna is enough to get on the air. Now, we have a lot of antennas here because it looks impressive, and they all work, and but we like to demonstrate them too, but still, we show people some modest antennas on what they can get on the air with, and of course, we've got the elaborate ones also to get the attention of the public.
Yeah, I mean, the big super antenna farm, that may almost be overload for people thinking they have to duplicate that at home.
Well, we tell them they don't have to duplicate that. You know, a simple dipole gets you on the air, and it works very, very well. So we communicate that to people and let them know that how simple that is. Or just a simple quarter-wave vertical is just fine also.
Bill was saying that you started fundraising, what, back about March?
Yes. We did a fundraiser where we're raffling.
Yeah, he told us about that.
So he told us about that.
But I'm thinking about the general planning. Will you start planning for this the day after this fair closes for next year?
Absolutely.
You're going to do it next year?
Oh, absolutely. There's always the first thing you think of are all the things that you would do a little bit better and a little bit different for the next one.
It's what's on your list right now? A little better, a little different?
Well, you know, we're a little further away from the traffic area, so maybe being a little closer.
But you're next to the Pigway Speedway.
We're next to the Pigway Speedway, and we smell barbecue, so maybe that's the loser of the pig race that's on the barbecue spit. But we do. We always have things that we go, well, next year, you know, we'll do this a little bit better. And
so you'd like to be in a higher traffic area, but wouldn't everybody?
That's true. That's true.
And probably a lot of the people in the high traffic areas, they're paying big bucks for their spot.
They are. And I think we get a very affordable place here. So, but being physically just a little bit closer to that traffic area.
That would be good. Although, once again, it would be hard to put up the antenna farm.
Well, there's a trade-off. Always a trade-off.
You're going to end up in that urban environment, a postage stamp lot, and no place to put up antennas. That's very analogous to, I don't know, what, ham radio.
It could be. Could be.
So, all right, so more traffic. Yeah, what else might be on your list?
Always, you know, you can't publicize it too much. You can't get the word.
Talking about getting hams in or to the general public?
Both. Let the hams know that the other hams in the area know that we're here, that we're set up, we're operating. We'd love to have them come by and love to have them get on the air if they haven't been on the air for some time, and get them active and interested in amateur radio. As well as to be able to share with the public their stories about how they got into amateur radio and what they're doing today.
How far out in terms of time is it effective to start recruiting staff? 12 months is too far.
12 months
Six
is too
months
far.
6 months maybe too far.
6 months is probably too far because people's schedules change. My schedule changed this past week, so everything is sort of fluid, but getting people committed and on a schedule is probably a month to 6 weeks out.
So you got a couple of one radio club meeting for each of the clubs mm-hmm. that's participating. Mm-hmm. Maybe two club meetings would be a good idea.
Two club meetings, and we've been attending those club meetings, letting them know that we're going to be here, we're going to be on the air and set up, and we'd love to have their support and come by and promote amateur radio, because they wind up being the recipients of a lot of the people who decide to go forward with their amateur radio license.
Bill has wandered back into the frame here. Are we doing okay?
You're doing okay. That there's several weeks of committee meetings, getting a representative from each club. We actually do something fascinating. We meet on the internet. We communicate using internet, and have a weekly meeting organizing the fair event and planning and so forth and so on. So
what medium do you use on the internet?
We use a
Skype, GoToMeeting.
TeamViewer exactly is what we do use. And we
saw audio or video.
Audio feed, and sometimes we have video, but primarily audio. And that way we can pull everyone in, and nobody has to do a lot of traveling. But, you know, we have these clubs are scattered, over Western North Carolina. And of course, we and Carl Bowman was involved in it.
Carl's the North Carolina section manager.
Yes, and so he was able to join us in some meetings and some planning. And
he was a waste of time, wasn't he?
Oh, well, yeah. He only spent several days working with us and helping us and getting us organized, and we appreciate his help.
All right. So, but 2 months out for club meetings and stuff. For your general staff, when do you recruit your board members or your committee? You got to get them in.
As soon as you get a chairman, he starts hooking. But
okay.
I'm chairman this year because everybody else ran away. But
it was one of those, everybody who wants to volunteer, step forward, and everybody else went like
yes,
this.
Yes, yes, yes.
We were standing there going,
happened, yes.
Where'd everybody go?
Last year's chairman up and moved away. What can I say? But so, hi, Kevin.
Hi, Kevin. We heard screaming.
Something like, well, he went and got a job that paid more money and moved out of state. I don't know why he would do that. He could be chairman again this year. But Mitzi did a fantastic job last year and taught us how to do it.
Okay, so who put together all this stuff? There's a lot of displays and equipment and cards and multimedia. Who puts all that together, and how long does that take? And Dave, you can chime, or Dean, you can chime in here if you want.
Well,
but you need the microphone.
I didn't have any part in doing that, but I didn't have any part in putting that together.
Well, that wasn't the plan either. Now.
And
no.
Now you need the mic. I need to teach you guys how this television thing works.
Oh, this television thing. Well,
the folks out there, they don't lip read.
Let's put it this way. Dean was in charge of meet and greet folks. Well, he had a family emergency this week, and we filled in for him. He's also supposed to have had surgery this morning, but
they're standing.
He's still standing. but we won't tell him anything about that. But we certainly appreciate all the help he's offered us. And as you noticed, one of the towers out there has a 6 meter, a 2 meter, a 440 beam on it. Dean and Howard, his running buddy, are going to run the VHF contest from the fair this weekend. They are avid contesters. So
there's mountains surrounding us. You got no signal anywhere.
Oh, well.
You're not on top of one of those
mountains. They seem to do pretty good.
You need to be on top of a mountain for
them? Generally, we are. There's only three essential things in VHF contesting, and that's elevation, elevation, and elevation.
Yeah. Also altitude.
Well, that too, if you can work it out, but
and antenna height above average terrain.
Well, all those things work, but if you're in the right spot and 6 meters is open, it's wonderful.
Yeah, if we can get a 6 meter opener.
So,
all right, so who put all this stuff together? One guy?
Oh, absolutely not. No, we. Bill could probably tell you all of the principles involved in putting all this together, but we've got people from all over the counties that have come and have helped assemble this, put it together, and then we've also got some fellows that have been here working every day from daylight to dark. So we run the gambit of people who have a little bit of time or a lot of time.
I do have to acknowledge that you offered me some space to put a Ham Radio Now exhibit together, and I told you there's no way I was going to be able to do that. And you put one together for me.
You also said you weren't going to show up.
Well, I said I couldn't promise, but here I am. So. At least I was.
Well, that was because we offered you a fair dinner.
Hey,
you couldn't return it. You couldn't turn it down.
Yeah, this would be cool. All right, is there anything else that you wish I had asked you about, or are you just kind of wishing I would now go away?
You might want to talk to Philip.
To who?
Philip.
I wish you'd ask more people to come in and find out about amateur radio.
Okay, well, unfortunately, this is not a not live and not going to the public. It's going to hams, but you like to see hams too. Have the hams, local area hams, not the ones that volunteered, but just the local area hams who live around here, they come by and get impressed?
They come by, but generally, that's one of the things we could do better is publicize to the hams, because a lot of them that come by go, oh, I didn't know you were going to be here. And so that gives, again, the opportunity to either engage them and say, well, come on in. We've got a special event station. How would you like to operate the November 4 Foxtrot special event station?
You can recruit them right on the spot.
We recruit them right on the spot, and we get picked up operators that way.
Okay, Dean, thank you very much.
Okay.
Who have we got here? And what's your role in this? They just shoved you in front of the camera for me.
Philip in 4-HF, and I'm secretary for the Roadshow ARC, plus webmaster, plus quartermaster, and I was asked to be fair chairman, and I said, do you want me to quit the club altogether?
Yeah, another overloaded ham.
Yes. So
what have you done out here?
Last year I had APRS and WindLink set up, did that, helped put up the antennas kind of thing. I've been more of inside, putting the inside displays together, although not
you're
supposed
a worker
to grow. Yeah. Than doing the outside, putting up antennas, but just more inside displays, that kind of thing.
How do you decide what's worth your time, what's worth putting together, and what is unrealistic, too much effort, or is just that no one's going to ever understand it without a college course?
Well, last year we had a couple of students from Western Carolina University Radio Club, which I'm a member of since
course.
I'm on this. So, but that club has gone inactive right now because there are no student members. So they were doing EchoLink and IRLP here last year. Well, one of them has moved away for a job, and the other one has moved even farther west in North Carolina. And so we decided we're not going to do EchoLink or IRLP because none of us in the club were that familiar with it.
Didn't learn last year.
No.
Didn't spend enough time at the station figuring how it works.
Well, this is so much. It's hard working in the booth here because if you're in here by yourself, you're expected to know everything. I know very little. We have a D-Star station. I know very little about it.
Yeah.
I'm more familiar with APRS, WindLink, that kind of thing. Or working HF and the aircraft behind me.
And yeah, I wish I'd known that you guys had APRS display that you do. I would have told you to watch me
as I approached.
Where did I leave from this morning? From Auburn, Alabama.
I saw you when you got to Greenville because you showed up on the screen over there. And I told Bill, I said, well, Gary's in Greenville right now.
Yeah, there's some dead areas in APRS.
Yeah.
Are you big into APRS?
Somewhat.
I've gotten
more so because the group at Western Carolina University that I mentioned, one of the physics majors there, KK4NRB, Michelle, who just graduated, she had been doing high-altitude balloon launches. And I started helping her with that last November. At the screen to my right shows some of the pictures from the balloon itself.
That's that and over there. I got some close-ups of that.
So that's what really got me more into APRS, was because we have APRS on the balloon, a transmitter, with the GPS, of course.
And does the public here get interested in balloon stuff, or does that go over their head?
No, I try to break it down for them. I put a little placard together of what equipment we had in the balloon. That's why I'm displaying the pictures. There's some really beautiful shots that catch people's attention, curvature of the earth and all that. And people see that like, what is that? And I think that's sort of a hook for them to find out what APRS is and ham radio in general.
You've got the AMSAT badge on here.
Yes.
Did I miss it, or is there any satellite stuff showing here?
No, I tried to do it last year, and circumstances just prevented it, and I thought, we've got too much else going on. It became a priority of, do we want to try to do satellite stuff? If I do satellites, do I want to just do FM like the ISS or SO50, or do I want to try some of the linear sats too? So I tried SO50 last year, and there was just too much noise outside for me to be successful at that. So I hadn't even tried it this year.
So that is one of those things where you decide this isn't worth the effort it takes to put into it. Because would people who don't have familiarity with amateur radio understand what they're seeing? They'd understand the word satellite. That might be cool, but do they get anything else?
Funny you should say that, because I had experience at Field Day this year. I was only going to listen to ISS because I knew there was no point in transmitting that day. So I had an aero antenna there at our Field Day site, which was at a Sam's Club in Asheville, Sam's Club parking lot in Asheville. And one of the passes, it wasn't a very high pass. It was only about 13, 14 degrees elevation. But I actually had a guy who was interested in ham radio but didn't have his license yet. He actually got to hear this ISS that went over. And he was just, Really? That was the ISS. He is now a general class.
So that worked.
Yeah, less than a month later. So yeah, that...
That worked well.
Like, yeah, things like that hook them.
The satellite demonstrations with the HTs and the aero antennas, they're good at hamfests because the hams already know
yeah.
what it's all about. They just have never heard it themselves.
Yeah.
But for the public, it's a tougher sell, harder to explain.
Well, I think for the linear sats, the public's going to be like, why do you have to listen to, when public listens to sideband on HF, they're like, why do you settle for such lousy audio quality? So I would probably go with an FM satellite to do a demo for the public because the audio quality is better. You have Doppler shift even on the LEOs, low Earth orbit satellites, but it's much easier to, the audio is enough, is of course FM quality, to hook people like, wow, you really can talk and listen to a satellite and International Space Station and all that. So
they get that is an interesting thing for people.
Yeah.
Especially the space station. That's mm-hmm. manned. There's people there. They can understand that. So what has been the absolute most successful thing about this setup that you have seen in terms of intriguing the public?
One thing that was really popular last year, and not so much, I haven't seen it so much this year, was the 2-meter go-to station, especially with kids. We had a lot of kids get on last year and talk to one of the guys who lives out in Silva, about 50 miles from here. And they're like, they were just taken by that, 9-10-year-olds. I haven't seen that as much this year.
They know where Silva is.
Yeah.
So they get an appreciation for the distance.
Yeah. I think putting the Elecraft radio in here, as they probably told you, we didn't have an HF station in the tent last year. So we did this year. I think that's generated some interest because I can point to the 2-meter Linko the APRS station is running. And then say, this is for local communications. This is police frequencies, fire frequencies, that kind of thing. I said, if you want to work longer distances on a more regular basis, you go to one of the radios like it's over on the desk behind me, the Elecraft, which does the shortwave bands. I'm like, oh, really? And it's nice to have stations on there who are in different countries. We've been keeping this one on 20 meters, but have stations in different countries who are on there, and that station's really that in that place? So that having that rig in here, we just plan to use it mostly for digital, for HF, for CW and PSK31, but it's wound up being used more for sideband. That's generated more interest than I thought it would. And to my right, there's a workbench that's new for this year as well, where we've decided to build some J-poles out of copper pipe and out of twin lead.
So you get somebody sitting over there working on something, do people just kind of look over their shoulder?
No, that hasn't really generated the interest that we thought it would. We wanted to do that show. This is what you can do, build kits, that kind of thing. Because Tentec has got us some great kits to build over there. But it hasn't generated the interest from the public to stand there and watch that we thought it might.
Have you thought of specifically scheduled or timed events? I'm not sure how you would do that and let people know so that they would show up here specifically. But was that ever discussed?
No, any of the satellite work, of course, would have to be scheduled because they're not here all the time. But
you're not inviting people specifically for them. It's just whoever happens to be there.
No,
they get lucky.
Right. Some things we wish we could do every day. Like we had a Windlink station that the one of our Mars directors, he set it up earlier in the week. He hasn't been here every week, but people were really impressed by Windlink last year, and I thought he would be here more than he was to show them that. But like, you can really send text messages, send email over radio kind of thing. And when I've been demonstrating on the APRS station, Windlink on APRS station, I explained how it goes. I said, it's going from here via VHF 2-meter link to a station about 15 miles away. From there, it connects from his house to the internet and goes to one of the five servers around the world. So when the email comes back, it comes to his house, then it goes back to RF and comes back here. So,
do people get impressed at the concept of being able to operate without infrastructure, or are they so used to having infrastructure that always works that is not a thing anymore?
One thing we've really stressed this year more is how is that infrastructure, and we have a lot of people actually ask about that, that specifically, how. What do you do if the infrastructure goes down? And I've been giving specific examples of Katrina and Sandy, and especially today with the World Trade Center, 13 years ago.
Yeah, this is 9/11.
Yeah.
This is the day.
Yeah.
Hang on, moment of silence.
Okay.
I forgot about that.
because I mentioned that the Emergency Communications Center in New York City was located in one of the towers. I said, guess what? They had no emergency communications for 24 hours. So they were relying on ham radio. I said, and if our infrastructure goes down, a lot of us have generators or solar power, battery backup, that kind of thing. It was short term.
All right. Anything else that you could think of about the way an operation like this gets put together that people who might be thinking about doing the same thing? First of all, is your number one piece of advice, don't do it, run screaming for the hills?
No, it we generally...
Absolutely worthwhile.
We generally I'm an optimist, but we generally anticipate disaster, how badly it's going to be, and it actually comes together. There's always last-minute things to do that didn't get done, or last-minute things that we want to work that don't. But then again, we think of things at the last minute that, oh, let's do this. We have the equipment and that kind of thing. I did have a suggestion earlier today that we may implement next year, and that's to have just a receiver sitting out near the front blaring CW out into the regular fairgrounds. So people are going to walk by and say, what is that noise? And maybe that would draw some more people in.
Do you have stations people can put their own hands on and play with maybe just a little instruction?
The go-to station, we have somebody there, of course. We generally don't
allow... That's a 2-meter radio. There's nothing to do but push the button.
Yeah.
I'm talking about maybe, you know, just tuning an HF rig. I don't know if that would really mean something to somebody, but...
Well, I generally approach talking about HF rig this way. I talk about how CB has discrete channels in one band. I said, well, we have 10 or 12 bands we can use with a whole lot of frequencies.
Which, by the way, I've gone on record as saying they should all be channelized.
And... that's how I explain HF. I said some of these some of the bands on HF are good for local communications. Some are good for longer distance communication. I explained to them that I'm generally on 20 meters when I'm here. This is one for longer distances. So I'm out here, someone in Texas, I might hear someone in Spain, that kind of thing. So I'll sit there and let them watch me operate. If they really seem intrigued, I might. We take very few people back to the operating trailer because it's so cramped back there, but. We did take a few people back there last year and let them, I think a few actually operated, got on the mic kind of thing. So, yeah.
So that's where the trailer next door is where most of the actual on-the-air stuff is happening?
Yeah, that's where the special event station actually is.
Yeah, that's N4F?
N4F, yeah. N4F. And, but we decided to do, like I said, the Ellicraft we decided to do in the tent this year because we wanted more people to be exposed to the HF side of it. That ham radio is not just 2 meters.
Works.
Yeah, it seems to be working.
All right. Anything else?
No.
We have covered it.
No.
Bill's got something else. Step right in here, Bill.
I'll step right in. I just happened to remember that we have a special guest coming to the fair this week.
Who is coming?
This Saturday, Wiley E. Fox. Do you know Wiley?
Not ringing a bell.
Wiley attends our monthly swap meet that we have. It's one of the roadshow events. Wiley is a very foxy individual. He hides in somewhere, and we go around with radios and try to find him.
Oh, you're going to have a fox hunt.
Yes, Wiley E. Fox, of course. We've got some older handheld scanners that obviously don't transmit, so we can put them on Wiley's frequency, and we can put them in the hands of some young people with supervision and go find Wiley. Now, if that doesn't hook them into... some of the fun things that we can do with amateur radio, I don't know what will.
So I was asking Phil if you had some specifically scheduled activities that you publicize, and this is definitely one.
This is definitely one. We're not going to put it out on the PA system, but we're going to have it in here, and as people come by, young people come by who show some interest, hey, come back. We're at such and such time, we're going to go hunt for Wiley.
I just had a genius idea, a brilliant, I'm on camera. You need to work a deal with the Hogway, Pigway, Speedway guys so that when they finish with one of their races, it's, all right, ladies and gentlemen, now if you want to see some real hams, you need to go next door over to that tent and you'll see some really live hams.
That's what we need. More promotion in ham radio. Actually, Wiley will probably hang out with the blacksmith, because the blacksmith at the fair It's
you
a
just,
ham.
You just give, okay, you've just given away the location of the fox.
Oh, so. No, I've given away. Well,
fortunately for you, this won't be on the air until that has passed, at least by a couple of days.
Oh, well, so, you know.
Well, tell you what, let's all sign this program off. Have you ever made it to the end of a Ham Radio Now program?
No.
And very few people do. All right, here's how it works. I say, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4EQ. You say who you are.
I'm Bill, N4OC.
And I'm Philip, N4HF.
And I say over, you say and you say out. Got to swap the microphone there. Over.
And
out.